whispers the little card, he says, Dave, over at Heroic Replicas. Might do a close-up of that card. He makes these Master Sword replicas. And he wanted to do a collaboration. And I said, sounds good to me. I made this block just by squishing it in the vise. This is a very awkward thing to drill. Luckily, there's this groove here. Beep, beep. And this thing up here, so the thing is kind of locked in place. But I'm still paranoid about this guy winding up in the right place. Is that anything like lined up? Maybe. Yow! Yow!
Yow!
I guess it is. Whew! So I took it as far as I could with that little wood block. And here's hoping I can get the rest of it, that it got deep enough that I can try this and then burst out the other side without it going too funny. It has to burst out of a weird surface on the other side. I just want to get one final shot of this before I start drilling through the rest of this guy, because once I burst out the other side here and do the same on this other one, they're going to look real ugly until I get that pin through and weld on the top and shape it. So just while these things are relatively nice looking, just get a couple more shots of them. These were a real nice piece of shaping with the angle grinder, and they're about to be wrecked. It's called an airplane bit. Now, I don't know, it complained a bit going through, so let's see what we got. Ugh. So that's the idea, and then I'll weld on top of that to lock the pin in place and smooth everything back to being the way it was. But it, oh man, does it look ugly. Okay, this is hard to film, but with this guy on this side and this guy on this side, can this guy get all the way through? Okay, it can. Woo! So that's concern one. I'm going to test it on the blade to see, is it any different on the blade? But I have to nip these guys. Oh wait, that's the focal point. These guys come in a little bit too far, so I have to nip the tops, bottoms of these guys down a little bit, so the blade can slide in there as well. Actually, it'll be more visually, if I go from underneath. Okay, so the pin can go through. Whew! And I'm gonna tighten the fit by, where's my other little guys gone? Tighten the fit by welding these guys on in very specific places. If I could clamp these guys across here, that would be perfect. But I need to do that in a way that doesn't mar them. Now, what would happen if I do this? Nothing. Good. What happens if I do this? Nothing so far. Good. Now to get a little bit of weld in there. Why is it so dark? There's something weird happening with the shutter speed. It acted odd when I was welding these guys. Okay, that's upsetting. So, even though the display was saying that it was on auto, like all the exposures and the everything, it wasn't. Can I switch focus version mid-clip? I can, and it's working. So, I don't know what the hell had just happened to the camera. I'm always slightly worried that bizarre arc effects from the welder will cause the camera's electronics to malfunction. I'm not even sure was that the case, but it certainly looked like that was the case. So who knows? Anyway, that's the things welded. Now, because of my dumb plan to get this anodized instead of painting it, this little patch here is made up of lab metal and must have been a hole or something. So, and that would work fine for painting it, but I need to get rid of it for my anodizing plan. The material has quite a lot of porosity in it, but I think that's all of the lab metal gone, so I could add thinner aluminum in. It will not anodize the exact same color, but I think I've seen from the sample piece I sent off, I think it should be acceptable. Oh man, it's ugly as sin. I've actually not welded a lot of aluminum, like ever. Focus. But it behaved okay. I was worried the porosity would make it a mess. But the aluminum was weird. It like, I had the thing set to 200, which if this was steel, would have been plenty of amps. But holy crap, it was like melting. It felt like I was using a little blowgun to melt toffee or something. Like it was coming off the stick in big blobs and stuff. Just a very different behavior from the steel. Not steel, aluminum. I just want to mention that for grinding this off, I don't even know how safe it is, but I'm using a sandpaper disc. I've heard horror stories if you use a regular grinding disc. See the way even the sandpaper that the aluminum has all bound up to the disc? If you do it with a grinding disc, if the aluminum gets too hot, it can expand in the cracks of the grinding disc and cause it to explode. So, no grinding discs on aluminum. I've gotten used to saying aluminum over here because the Americans think it's endlessly funny when you say aluminium. They ask you to say it again and again. So now we're going to attempt to electro-etch the Triforce symbol onto the blade. I got my buddy who works at the high school to cut it out in the vinyl cutter. And so this guy is just for positioning. I'm just acetoning the surface because anything you can do at all to make sure that the vinyl actually adheres to the surface increases your chances of getting a good etch. And this is just to give a target, he said, hopefully. Holy crap. This kind of thing, very thin lines, is actually one of the most successful things you can try to etch. I found when etching big, wide, flat areas are very prone to failure. Much higher success rate with skinny things. This looks to me to be a similar surface area to the markings on the demon killing knife I did a billion years ago.
So I'm going to check how long I left that in the soup for. And that'll give me an indication of how long to leave this in the soup for.
So I think I forgot to record it. So I've just put a piece of clear tape on the design. I made it a little bit less sticky by doing this a couple of times. And now the stressful part is there's a square cut around the design. And can I liberate? Oh, here we go. Oh, perfect, perfect, perfect. I need to move the camera though. So the piece of tape on top keeps it all relative to each other, but I might move the camera over to where it needs to be so that you can see me applying it, which is a little bit more stressful. No, the light's wrong. God damn it. Maybe I'll bring this really close to the surface. Oh boy. Okay. The stickier you make it, the better it holds the design into position. The less sticky you make it, the easier this part is. Holy moly! So here we have the thing bubbling away. A piece of wire. Black is negative, the red's connected to the blade. It's 1 amp, 5 volts at the moment. And it's set to 1 amp maximum. So there, that's delivering the 5 volts. And I'm going to leave it in for 15 minutes and see what happens, because that would, like, this is even skinnier, I think, and even less amount of material to remove than was on the demon killing knife. They're very skinny lines. I don't have a universe B, but I wish I could see what would have happened if I left them in for half an hour. I'll have a look at the 15 minute mark and see, can I tell. So I'm having trouble focusing on the stuff underneath the water. But you can see the rust forming on the bottom as the salt etches away. I'm gonna take this off and put my finger in here. No, it's not hot. I do not want it to get hot, because if it gets hot, the vinyl fails, the walls start to melt, it's a mess. Oh, so I'm just gonna babysit it. Those bubbles are chlorine entering my bloodstream, making my thinking and speech patterns a little bit messier than they are normally. So this is kind of bizarre. See the yellow here? Normally the whole soup turns black, but with this soup it only turned black directly above the area it was etching. You can see here, this is yellow and this is yellow. I can brush it here. What I'm trying to detect is, okay, it looks like it got a clean etch. I'm trying to look into the bottom of what it burned, and it definitely looked like it's, ooh, the pattern's lifting. Okay, it's time to call it a day. The pattern's lifting, which is bizarre because it's still cold. So, I don't know. Oh, I hope I didn't wreck it. I guess we'll find out. Okay, I think it might be okay. Wow, even 15 minutes, I think, was a little bit too long. I'll leave in the other side for less time. But two things I want to do. I want to put coal blue into the cymbal to make it pop a bit more. And I want to brass these guys. So, because I'm worried about the heat, I have to sandbag both things when they're done. So I'm going to do the brass first. Now my problem doing this is always using too much heat, because I can't help myself. But you just kind of have to be patient. It's just a little bit of heat, and then you give it a brushy with the brush. Make sure it's an actual brush. Brush. God damn it. That burning on the surface, it looks like ebon when I gave him the job to clean it. He used quite a lot of acetone. Okay, that's one side of that done. Sand away all of this stuff. But yeah, so I tape it and then sand it all around the thing, obviously. And then that's way you can see the brass effect. I wonder. I think I liked it more when it was just silver. Yeah, the black, I don't know why. I thought the black would bring it out more. But the symbol, I think, is obvious enough without the black. I don't think it added a lot. Oh, there's still black there. The light in here is strange. Very harsh. So, people who have been following my YouTube will have noticed that this sword took a long time. And one of the reasons it took a long time is I didn't want to use paint on the guard parts because I don't like paint. It's just, I've never come across any version of it that's doesn't look like paint. You take your metal parts and you paint them and all of a sudden there's no difference between the metal parts and something made out of plastic or something. So, anyway. I got them anodized, and originally I was debating whether or not to make these guard parts purple or blue, but the anodizing place only had blue, so that's the color they are. Because they're cast, they came out kind of speckledy, but I still much prefer the look of this, and some of the welds, the textures and colors are slightly different around the welds, but yet again, I still am more comfortable with that than a painted finish. But anyway, this is done now, so the sword can finally move on to the next part. Originally, I was going to do the handle on the sword with two halves, because that's how the wooden pieces that were in the box with it were done. That anchored me to the idea of, oh, it's two halves of the thing that go around. But then I was thinking it would be actually much better if instead it was two discs, top and bottom, with a solid pipe in between. That one that flew off, I couldn't find it, so I actually cut a third one. Yo! It's hot. This disc of ice on top of the thing is thicker than I thought it was going to be. So in the back of the pommel, I luckily noticed that the hole was slightly off-centered, so we're going to make the hole in this guy slightly off-centered as well to try and match him up. And obviously it's a 3/8 threaded bar, so I might drill it bigger so then I can further like center this guy on the back of that pommel bit and then weld it on in the right location. And then the hope is when you tighten it down, it tightens down into this guy being actually centered. But it's a tricky thing to get perfectly right. I'm slightly worried about it. Now, is this thing... There we go. Ooh! Maybe not. Would it be great if I could weld it on like that? With this head here. But I'm not sure how will that interact with the pipe bit. Ooh, maybe. But I also wanted to weld inside here. I'd have to leave space. Maybe I could weld it on like this and then shave that down or something. Okay. The inside of that pipe had rust on it, and although it's technically that, like, the... Oh my god, can... Is this still too hot to touch? It's not like stuff rusts more. The only way it would rust more is if there was moisture trapped in there. But I'm always fascinated by this black surface that's on a vinegar boiled thing after it comes out. I wish there was a way to keep it on there. I've heard of people getting knives bit out of other stuff to turn black by boiling it in vinegar. Anyway, just clean out any loose rust from the inside. I made a big mess because I wasn't keeping an eye on it and it overflowed. It's over by the door. At least I had the good sense to do it by the door. Oh yeah, the inside of that looks clean now. Nice. I had a moment where I was like, oh, it won't work because there was paint on the outside of the pipe. And if they painted the inside of the pipe too, then the vinegar won't be able to boil it off. And then I was like, Mike, there's no... Why would they have painted the inside of a pipe? And I was like, oh yes, I am stupid. So I just acetoned all the marks off. But, so this is set, sit in that offset hole, and then it's tightened down. And then it was a real pain in the butt tightening it. And where's my vernier gone? By measuring off this edge, because like what else do I have to go off? You know, I drew two lines. One side, it was 7.36 or something like that for it to be the same distance either side. The other way it was 7. This is good to weld. I'm gonna weld this to this. And then this is tightened down a lot, but if it does come loose, I'll throw some thread lock in the hole and then tighten it down again. I forgot to look up whether how thread lock interacts with aluminum. Does it do anything odd to it? And if it does, if it turns out it does, I can use epoxy or something. Okay, I welded that, and nothing strange happened, the anodized surface. I really should have looked up how anodized responds to heat before embarking on this. But I guess I can go inside and look that up now for future reference. Abrupt cut to me standing here! The divine absurdity of the blind idiot god algorithm still decrees that I vivisect my content lest I want to evanesce. There should be a box floating on this screen with a link to a playlist of all the parts of this build that have been uploaded. If not all the parts of this build have been uploaded, then they'll be uploaded once a week till they are all there. Alternatively, you can become one of my Patreons. The full build video is up on Patreon right now, including the part where I swing the sword around while apparently wearing the wrong elf costume. If YouTube has changed its thing yet again, and there's no box with a link to the playlist, there'll be a link in the video description.